family, how are we today? Amen. We serve an awesome God.
Amen.
We serve a faithful God. We serve a loving God. The God who knows the end from the beginning. That's a good thing. Because that's the God that we should be able to trust with our life. Right?
Amen.
Amen. You are wonderful, Lord. Can you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you, thanking you for this day. Thanking you, Lord, for allowing your Son to shine in to our lives today. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to wake up in our right mind. Thank you, oh Lord, for giving us strength to get out of bed and to make it here so that we can hear you speak and that we can worship you and live the life that you have called us to live, surrendered to your will. Father, we need you right now. Oh Lord, I need you right now. Father, I pray that you would speak to us in a way that we not only hear it, but that you stir something up inside us, that we live it out, that we put it into action. Lord God, I pray for your Holy Spirit to poke us right where we need to be poked so that we can be changed. Lord God, not allow us to remain the same, but change us in our mind and in our heart. Again, Lord, we need you. And we know that we cannot find any resolve without you being the core of it. So, Father, we pray that you would touch us, heal us in the areas that we are sick, renew us and restore us, Lord, that we would be who you have called us to be. And we will continue to praise. We will continue to exalt you. So, Lord, increase in me as I decrease to speak your word. Have your way. We ask these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Again, God is faithful. He is wonderful, right?
Amen.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. He has been too good to us and has shown us great things for us to be lame. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to learn something today. It's going to be about the truth in love. And we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to cover all of the verses.
Amen.
I may be in and out of my outline depending on how he moves me.
Amen.
So just bear with me. All right? All right. Before we get into the scripture, you guys should have a handout along with the outline. And it looks unique. And I will explain it. Does everybody have this handout? It looks like this. A whole bunch of circles and some lines next to it. All right. Now, the Lord had shown me this a long time ago, and I kind of put it to the side. Shame on me, because it says a lot. These circles says a lot. And I got a hold of it again because this is a book that I'm reading. It's called The Cure. And what started this right here, this handout, was in the book, they said that there were two paths that an individual had to go down, and they had to choose which path to take. And one path, it was about trusting God. And then the other path was pleasing God. And you had to make a decision which was the right path to take. I don't know about you, but that kind of messed me up. Choose the path to please God or choose the path to trust God. So I know the end result, but do you guys know which path to take first? Anyone?
Trust.
Period. Trust. That is the right path to take. But I had to look at my life and look at what is my makeup in this journey. Am I living to just trust in the Lord and let Him work everything out? Or am I trying to work everything out and asking Him to fix it as it gets messed up? Does anybody relate? Huh? Because at first, you know, when I read this book, I was like, oh, wow, I got this all messed up. Trying to please God, but also trying to please man. Right? Wanting to look a certain way. Wanting to act a certain way so that somebody may think that I have it together. And the truth is, I don't. I don't have nothing together without Christ being in my life. So this diagram here, the first circle, matter of fact, you guys can write number one for the first one, two for the second one, three, four, so forth. The first circle, I don't think that any of us can relate with. The first circle is me in my own world, and God is not in it. We don't have to worry about that, right? Right?
Right.
The second one is, it's my world, and I do acknowledge that there is a God, but I'm still in control. Because the chair is the captain's seat. The captain's seat is the one who it controls the ship, right? Now the third one is where I have some problems. I recognize the importance of God. And He's in my life. But I'm still sitting in the captain's chair. I'm still making decisions without going to Him first. I'm still doing things without really asking the Lord first. And then the fourth one is that God takes control, and that He is the captain, that He is the Lord of our life. But guess what? In order for that to take place, there has to be a trust issue that's resolved. That we place our total trust in Him to be Lord over our life and not to allow us to get in the way. Trust. And that comes from true love of the Lord. Self-sacrificing love. That it's not about me. That it's about Him first and truly putting ourselves in that situation. That makes sense? Yeah. Y'all looking at me like, nah.
It makes sense.
But it makes sense? Yeah. So, There has to be a change in this circle, the third circle, that we get off of the throne and that we allow God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit to be Lord in our life, and that we submit and surrender. And that will give us our true faith, our true trust in the Lord. And when we do that, guess what we receive? The Spirit of God. And from the Spirit, what do we receive? The fruit of the Spirit, which is the subject today. Truth and love. Love. So if you guys are with me in chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, we're going to read verses 1 through 13. Did this help? Does it show us where we are? I admit I need a lot of work. I need a lot of work. Chapter 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. I want to stop right there. Section one. We know that we're living in an evil time. We know that the world that we're living is unloving, unforgiving, and they lack self-control. The world that we live in. I don't think that it's fitting for us not to allow the love of God to flow out of us in this type of world that we're living in. Because what happens? Paul said, you amount to nothing without this love. You can do nothing without this love. And Paul, he speaks to the Corinthian church because the Corinthian church is jacked up on focusing on gifts, because you can speak in tongues. And I like how Paul kind of dealt with the real issue. He said, y'all speak in tongues thinking that you're speaking heavenly language, right? He said, but it doesn't matter. Because if you don't have love, it means nothing. So because you can speak to men and you can speak to the angels in this language, without love, you can do nothing. It means nothing. He says, matter of fact, it's like sounding brass, noise. You ever talk to somebody, you think they know it all? And without love, everything that come out your mouth is wrong. You don't know what you're talking about. You ain't spend enough time with the Lord. You need to go ahead and devote some more time so that you can really hear from God, so that you can speak in tongues and all that mess. Don't they annoy you? Don't you wish that you had the gift to shut their mouth? Like snap, and now your mouth can't talk no more, so the truth can come out, right? Paul is telling them, regardless of your abilities, regardless of your gift, and here, tongues, if you don't have love, it's noise. It's noise. But what I want us to understand is that as mature believers, now real quick, show of hands, how many of us want to grow in our maturity in Christ? All of us, right? And the only way that we can grow in maturity is that we really embrace love, the truth, and then pursue it because the world needs it. The world needs to see the love of God. You guys agree?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, mature believers must embrace the truth in love and pursue love in obedience. Now, what's important about this love? Letter A. Paul rebukes the Corinthian church for not desiring the fruit of the Spirit over spiritual gifts. Even though the Spirit of God gives spiritual gifts, he also produces spiritual fruit from within us. If you turn to Galatians 5, 22 to 23, what's the first gift? Fruit.
Love.
Do you think that God put that there on accident? So if we say that we are believers, then what should be the first fruit that they see in us?
Love.
So this kind of love is needed in order to be effective in the edification of the body of Christ. You guys agree?
Yes.
Because even in chapter 8 of 1 Corinthians, Paul says that knowledge, all it does is puff up. Mm-hmm. And here's the thing too. Everybody knows about Jesus. Everybody knows what Jesus did. But when we say, yeah, I know that he's Lord, is he Lord in your life? Is he Lord in all that you do? Because if not, then guess what? We're just operating off of knowledge. And that's why the third circle I thought was significant, because we know who Jesus is. We know what he did. But he's not Lord in our life. And Pastor had made a statement a couple of Sundays ago. We could easily lose sight of Jesus and get caught up in the religious. Right? Doing the things that we know God would approve of, but it's after he has told us to go do it. In order for us to hear that, we have to have a relationship with him. Right? In order for us to hear that, we have to have a relationship with the Lord. If not, then all we're doing is assuming that this is what he wants done. Right? Another significance about this diagram is the fact that we know about God, we know about the Lord, we know about Jesus, but do we really have that intimate relationship with him where we say, we know him and he knows us, right? There's this favorite scripture of mine that I always remind myself of. And it's the scripture where it says, Lord, Lord, did we not cast out demons in your name, prophesy in your name? And he says, I never knew you. So you look at that diagram and that third circle. The fourth circle is God's perfect design, that he is Lord in our life, right? So if you go back over that scripture where he says, I never knew you, he said, I never knew you as me being Lord in your life. I was just something on the side. When things got hard, that's when you talked to me. when things are good, I don't hear from him. So he can say, I never knew you. In this intimate relationship that I designed for me to have with you. Because you never surrendered and submitted yourself to me. So I say that all because in this learning about love, we have to recognize where we are. And if we're sitting on the captain's seat, we need to get off. We need to acknowledge that we're in sin and repent and submit ourselves under God's lordship the way that he designed it. Because if not, there's going to be a day when he returns and he's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. You recognized where you were and you still didn't change. You still stayed on my throne. I don't think that that's somewhere we want to be. If he's showing us where we are right now and we have room to change, let's change. Because the day is going to come. And what we really want to hear is, well done, good and faithful servant. Right? So we recognize the importance of the love. And we know from the first couple of verses that if we don't have love, then we're nothing. So what is this love? This love is found in 1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. 1 John 4:7. And anyone who loves is born of God and knows God. So born of God. You ever hear somebody say, yeah, I'm born again? Mm-hmm. But yet they still living for the world. You have to question if they've really been born again. Right? Is it wrong for us to question? Because when you're born again, something happens in your heart. Your heart becomes regenerated.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. And then the things that you used to like, you hate.
That's right.
Because God hates them.
Yes.
So if we still entertain it, then guess what? We may not be born again. That's a little reality that we're going to have to address soon. Because if we are entertained by the world, if we enjoy what the world has for us, knowing that God detests it, then whose side are we really on? That makes sense? What is love? This love is agape love. It's unselfish, self-sacrificial desires and interest for the well-being of self. Did y'all see that? That's right. It ain't about self. It's about somebody else. Right? Self-sacrificing love, desire, and interest of someone else that should be receiving that love. Do we have that inside? Are we willing to get out of our comfort zone to serve one another? I know sometimes we don't feel like it, but love is not about feeling. Love is about action. Love is about going through even when it doesn't feel good.
That's right. Amen.
I want to bring marriage in real quick. Not that this section is about marriage. It's about a relationship with the Lord and allowing the Lord to be center in our life. But marriage is hard. Marriage takes effort. It's work. And you're going to always be stretched in marriage. You're going to always go through circumstances that you don't like and don't feel like going through.
Amen.
But it's this agape love that allows you to stand firm in what God has told you and to move in it. And sometimes we don't see the reward. Sometimes we don't get the reward at that present time. But when you do what God has called us to do, and guess what? God commanded us. He said, love one another. That's a command. So when it comes to our spouses, guess what? Even when they don't deserve, we're still supposed to love them. And love them the way that God told us to. And that's hard. But when we do it, guess what? God is saying, well done. God is pleased with us standing firm on his word.
Amen.
That's important. This is what love looks like. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down his life for a friend. Again, as mentioned, love is not emotion and feeling. Love is deliberate action. Love is giving when you may not feel like giving. Love may be standing when you don't feel like standing. You feel like giving up. I'm tired. I don't want to do this no more. Did Christ say that to us? Did he say, I don't want to do this no more? I'm done. I'm through. I can't deal with this no more. I'm finished. No. He stood and he went through it for us. And that's the love that we're supposed to have for one another. So how do we get this love? Now that we know what it's about, how do we get it? Can we just go ahead and do it? Or is there a step? Is there a process? There's a step. Process. We have to grow in love, right? But we have to put our first step forward and our best step forward, right? We're going to trust God. We're going to move forward and allow him to continue to pave the way, right? So when we believe and place our trust in the person and works of Christ Jesus, that's when we receive the Spirit of God. And that's when we are enabled to love with a regenerated heart, being born again. And I believe that when we do that, we know that faith comes by hearing. But that faith is active. I mean, there's a response when we hear that. That we say, Lord, I can't do this. Lord, I cannot live this life without you. I can't do this on my own. Every time I do, I mess up. I need you to be my Lord. I don't want it anymore. I don't want to be in control anymore. I want you to lead and guide me. And when we have that heart, he comes and he becomes Lord in our life. And we have to, at every moment, step aside and let him be that in our life. God does not make us do nothing. We have to want him to do that. So if we are in a place where we are on the captain's seat, let us pray that we get uncomfortable. Let us pray that we don't like being in that seat. Let it get hot. Let it get very unbearable so that we can say, Lord, here. Because that's what we're going to need. We need that type of conflict in our life to recognize that he needs to be Lord in my life. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So this is how love should look. So I'm going to go back to verse 4. Love suffers long. In other translations, love is patient. Love is kind. And understanding kind. Kind is not letting any and everybody walk all over you. Kind is speaking the truth in love. Is responding in love. When you see a wrong, that you stand and address it, but in love. With kindness, having the potential to tear stuff up, but being reserved, like, you know, that's not right. This is how it's supposed to be done. Some people don't have that. Some people would tear you up the opportunity that they get a chance to see you in wrong. There's an opportunity for you to ask, where is that agape love that you're supposed to have towards me, right? People can't wait to see us do wrong so that they can tell us about us, ourselves, who we are. That's not kindness. That's the opposite. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, does not boast. Love is not puffed up. Love is not proud. Love does not behave rudely. Love does not seek its own. Love is not provoked. Or love is not easily angered. Love thinks no evil or holds no record of wrong. Man. We got some family members, man, that will not let you go with whatever it is that you've done in the past. As soon as you get on the phone, hey, you remember you? You're like, for real? Is that what I get? I haven't talked to you in years, and that's the first thing that you're gonna tell me is, where's the love? Where's the love? Love does not rejoice in iniquity and sin and unrighteousness. But love rejoices in the truth. Now, I can't own this, but wherever there is love, let's put Christ in there. Let's go right from the top. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not Christ, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains but have not Christ, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned but have not Christ, it profits me nothing. Christ is patient, long-suffering. Christ is kind. Christ does not envy. Christ does not parade himself or is proud or boastful. Christ does not behave rudely. Christ does not seek his own. Christ is not easily angered or provoked. Christ does not think no evil hold that against us. What did he do? He died for us. He said, while we were sinners, he went to the cross to give his life for us. That's what he did. Do we have that same kind of love for one another? Christ does not rejoice in sin, but he rejoices in the truth. Christ bears all things, believes all things, and hopes all things, endures all things. The truth in love is that we need to have Christ. We need to embrace him and have him as the core of our life. Mm-hmm. Not as a genie, but as our Lord.
Amen.
Right? This kind of love is commanded for us. Letter C in section 1. To put into practice. God commanded us to love one another as he loved us. The expression of this love is in action, attitude, and behavior. Never in word or in tongue, nor in feeling or emotions. This love is deliberate and unconditional. Being patient or long-suffering is to be long-tempered, self-restrained in the face of irritation, annoyance, aggravation, and even torment. 1 Peter chapter 2, 19 gives us a pretty solid illustration of how we are to be. Chapter 2 of 1 Peter 19. For this is commendable. If because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully, for what credit is it if, when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called, to suffer, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. He who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously. That's love. And that's how we are to operate. And I know for some of us, that's a challenge. Mm-hmm. Somebody say something foul to us, we have it cocked, ready to load. All on it. Right? Right? And almost Christ is not present. Hmm? Well, we need to do better than that. We need to recognize, and this is truth, and I know it's hard, even in marriage. Remember, Paul told us that you don't wrestle with flesh and blood. But why do we respond like we got the right one?
Wow.
Hmm? Why can't we recognize that there is a demonic force behind that individual and that they don't know any better? How come we don't look at it like that? Because we're not where we need to be with the Lord. So we need to examine ourselves and see what's really here. Because what's here, that's what's going to show. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, we're almost done. We are to abide in this kind of love. That's what we've been told and commanded by the Lord. Mm-hmm. To abide means to remain, to stay in it and not leave, to be committed all the way to the end. Are we willing to do that? To be committed to this type of love? To allow God to flow through us and not us try and do it ourselves. Because again, Paul said, if you do it apart from the love of Christ, it has no effect. It means nothing. So how do we abide in his love? Letter A, We are to allow Christ to be Lord in our life and allow him to live in us. And I believe that the fourth circle is what that looks like. Is that the Lord is the Lord in our life, in our world, and we allow him to live through us. That's what it looks like, that we've surrendered to him. Verse 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'm going to finish the last couple of verses. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. It is very easy for many to get caught up in awe with the gifts of the Spirit. However, mature believers must know that the gifts of the Spirit are temporary, but love is eternally greater. Paul says love never fails, meaning that it's eternal. It will never stop, this agape love. And that even though people may misunderstand what the gifts are for, remember the gifts were to edify and build up the church. It had nothing to do with self. It was for the other.
Amen.
But Paul says, even so, when perfection comes, you need to let that go. Because you won't need it anymore. And we're waiting on that perfection. Amen.
Amen.
We're waiting on Christ to return. We're waiting to see him face to face. We're waiting for us to hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. Gifts won't mean anything at that time. And Paul wants the Corinthians to know that. Take your eyes off of speaking in tongues. It means nothing. And you should be able to see for yourself, you're not loving on your brothers and sisters. You're causing division. You're causing chaos. You're making something more than it should be for your benefit. So, well, that's going to end soon. Because when Christ returns, where will you be? Trying to hold on to something that's going to perish? Trying to hold on to something that will end, will be done away with? Why waste your energy? He said, seek the greatest gift. And we see what is greater is love that he planted in all of us who have made that conscious decision to let Jesus be Lord in our life. And we receive that. We get his Holy Spirit. We get the very Spirit of God living inside us, telling us what we should and shouldn't do. What's the wisest thing for us to do? To listen. Mm-hmm. Right? Because if not, what happens? Soft behind. Hard head. Soft behind. But we can avoid that if we just obey. Amen. Paul encourages us that this love is eternal, that this truth is based on scripture that says that God is love. And if you have love, then you know God. That you know him. Not head knowledge, relational. Having an intimate relationship with the true and living God. This is a thought. You're in a relationship with a significant other. Never spend time with them. Never find out what they like. Never find out what moves them. But you tell other people we're in a relationship. How do you feel? Like, dude, we ain't in no relationship. What kind of relationship you talking about? Right? So imagine that that's how we are with the Lord. What relationship? Every time I try and tell you something, you do the opposite. What kind of relationship is that? Right? But we tell people that we're believers, that the Lord is our Lord, but we don't operate like he is. We need to make certain that we are operating in his love and not our own. Believers should be anticipating Christ's imminent return. Let her be. At any moment, imminent. He can come at any moment. When he returns, there will be no need for the gifts any longer. The purpose of the gifts were to equip the saints for the work of the ministry and for the edification of the body of Christ. When he returns, we will be made complete to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, no longer being children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men. But we must grow in maturity. We said that we want to grow in maturity. Amen? Amen. In reference to verse 11, Paul says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. And we have to recognize that when we didn't know any better, we were immature. Right? And that even though we heard the word, we didn't do it. So we were still young and immature in our faith. Right? But what does he say? When I became a man, I let go of those things. I don't continue to act like I'm still a child. When we make a decision, to allow Christ to be Lord in our life, we should grow in our maturity. We should not still be children in the areas of our faith where we still are doing the things that we did before we came to Christ. We have no excuse to continue in the sin that we used to do, but now we have Christ in us. There's a possibility there might be a disconnect. We must grow in our maturity, which is only possible through agape love. Despite our growth in love, we only see or know, and the Greek term is to learn to know, grow to know and understand Christ partially. But when he returns, we will see him face to face. At that time, our faith will be complete. At that time, our hope will be fulfilled. As the Hebrew scripture says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. When we see Christ, our faith will be fulfilled because we see who we've placed our trust in. But Jesus said, it's going to be a great thing for those who have not seen me to still believe. We're going to eventually one day see Christ. Are we excited about that? Are we ready for him to come? That's the love that we have. And our love will continue. Therefore, as I close with this, let all that you do be done with love. And let your love be without hypocrisy. Hate what is evil and cling to what is good. For Christ is coming back. Are you ready?
Yes.
All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. Thank you, Father, for helping us to understand more the importance of your word and what love is and how it looks and what we should do with it. Father, we pray that from this day forward, we would see where we are in our relationship with you and that we would improve our relationship by trusting you with everything. That we would surrender our entire life to you and not allow it to be torn away and given to the world. Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit to continue to guide us and to lead us, Lord, and to order our steps.
Yes.
Again, O Lord, you are an amazing God, and there is none like you. And we pray, Father, that you would use us for your kingdom. Increase our faith in you. Increase our trust in you, Father. Cleanse us of our unrighteousness. Remove away from us the distractions that take our eyes off of you. Cleanse us, Lord. Help us to be more like your Son, our Lord, Savior of our life, Christ Jesus. We pray these things in Christ Jesus' name.